Good evening. How are you tonight? Again, may I have the privilege and the pleasure of coming into your home to visit with you for a little while. What would you like to talk about this evening on this anonymous telephone program? Now, this is a program where we take phone calls and entertain questions, but in my role as host of this program, I endeavor to relate your call wherever I'm able to the Bible. Because the Bible is God's Word. It is the absolute final authority in every area in which it speaks. It is a book that was written by God to you and to me, to every human being, not just to preachers and pastors and priests and so on, but to each and every human being. We should know more and more what the Bible teaches, because it is talking about you and about me. It is indicating how we are related to God Himself, the God who created this magnificent universe in which we live, and who has a plan for it and for you and for me. And we better know what that plan is, because God indicates He created us to be like God. That is, we were created in the image, in the likeness of God. And as part of that image, it indicated that we would not live like an animal until the breath of life is gone, but that we would exist forever, forever. Now, the problem is that if we rebel against God, and unfortunately, each one of us by nature have done that, the outlook is grim beyond measure, because the penalty for disobedience is eternal damnation. Oh, what a terrible, terrible piece of information that is. But the good news, there is a way in which we can become reconciled to God and indeed experience eternal life. And that is indicated in the Bible also. And that is what we want to know more and more about. And these are the kind of things that we talk together about on this program. Now, one of the areas that the Bible gets into in quite some detail and with great emphasis is the marriage institution. How important is that? We have letter here from an individual from Istanbul, Turkey. Oh, I'm always excited about a letter from Turkey, because Turkey is the land where the gospel first went out when the church age began about 2,000 years ago. Paul and Barnabas had been singled out by God the Holy Spirit and commanded to bring the gospel into the world, and they were sent out from Antioch, which was a city of the country that is now called Turkey. At that time, 2,000 years ago, it wasn't called Turkey, but nevertheless, today it is Turkey, and Antioch is still standing. And they were sent from there, and the first local congregations that were established were in the land of Turkey. And so for the first few hundred years, there was a lot of gospel in the land of Turkey. And then Turkey went through a time of spiritual nighttime. For well over 1,000 years, there has been no gospel of any consequence there at all. No true gospel, certainly. But now in this day, God again is opening the door to, in a wonderful way, to bring the true gospel to Turkey. And a consequence is, we have a letter here from a listener in Istanbul. He writes that he was born a Muslim, yet as he grew up, finally, he heard the gospel. He heard about the Lord Jesus. But in the meanwhile, he also had been having a real problem with marriage, because he writes that he has been married and divorced three times. And now his question is, who is my true wife? Well, the fact is that all three of your wives are your true wife. God recognizes multiple marriage, although that is not pleasing to God. Any marriage after the first, it becomes an adulterous marriage, but nevertheless, it is still recognized as a marriage. In the Old Testament, God gives the illustrations of occasionally an individual who was married to more than one wife, and they were never told to separate from the second or third or fourth wife, because those wives would have been adulterating the marriage to his first wife. And so, in direct answer to your question, to this individual's question, the answer is, you are married in God's sight to all three of these wives. Remember what 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 39, it says, the wife is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives. So your first wife is bound to you, your second wife is bound to you, your third wife is bound to you, and the consequence of this is that you cannot marry anyone else while any of these three wives are still living. In the event that all three of them died somehow, then you would be free to marry again, but not until then. Now, the wonderful news is, while on the one hand, now you should not contemplate marriage at all or any romance of any kind, but if you have become a true child of God, if you truly are saved, it does mean that all the sin that you've ever committed or ever will commit has been covered by the Lord Jesus Christ. It means that all the sin connected with your marriages and your divorces and all of this has all been covered, so that these sins are remembered no more. Now, the evidence of becoming a child of God will be that you have an intense desire to do the will of God. You will become very, very interested in the Bible and delight in the Word of God in the Bible, and you will have only one desire, and that is, oh Lord, help me to do your will. If it means that I have to remain single now and cannot marry another time, fine, that so be it. I'm just delighted that I know that you've rescued me from the penalty of my sins, and they've been many, and now I know that you are my Savior. And you can know, as you study the Bible, you can know that Christ will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, you probably are living in a city where there are not many true believers at all. Just a tiny, tiny, tiny little remnant that is just beginning to shape up, because we're in that day when there is a great multitude which no man can number that are being saved. And so you will feel very lonely at times. Ah, but you're not alone. You're not alone. Christ tells us, if we're a believer, he will never leave us nor forsake us. And just think, you can listen to family radio night after night and be comforted by the scriptures that you hear, be comforted by the music that is played, and be uh, encouraged to continue to read in the Word of God and continue to walk in a way that is pleasing to Christ. And remember that constantly you can have fellowship with God. He is with you all the time. You can pray, and you don't have to pray out loud. You can just pray silently in your mind. You can pray when you're lying down, or when you're walking, or driving, and simply talk with the Lord and thank Him for His blessings, and ask Him for strength to do His will. There's nothing better than to pray, "Oh Lord, help me so that you will work in me. You will work in me to will and to do of your good pleasure." So we are very, very grateful for your letter, to know that God's grace is apparently working in Istanbul, and I'm sure that God's word will not return void, because God promises that He will apply that word to the hearts of a great many people, and you would be one example of this. Well, thank you, Istanbul, for that letter. And now shall we go to our first caller on our telephone?
Hello,
line.
Mr. Campin.
Yes, good evening.
Hello, Mr. Campin.
Yes. Go ahead with your call.
Okay, thank you. Let me turn down my radio.
Sure.
Is that all right now?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, how are you this evening?
Yes, very well, thank you.
Yes, I've been listening to you from in the 90s, and I want to know about the saving grace.
Well, saving grace is the only grace that there is. Grace is the real definition, the biblical definition of grace is it's a gift, the gift of salvation. It is a gift that is given by God to all those whom He saves. It is nothing that we can earn. It's nothing that we can get by some action on our part. It is something that is a complete gift that is given to us, and we're not deserving of it at all. It means that we have become a new creature. We're given a brand new resurrected soul. It means that we were given eternal life. It means that in our new resurrected soul, we will never want to sin again, even though we will be somewhat troubled by sin, because we still live in a body that has not become saved. It means that we're guaranteed, when Christ returns in a few years, as all the evidence seems to point to, that we will instantly be given our brand new resurrected bodies, in which we'll never want to sin again, and we'll go to be with Christ forevermore.
Yeah, I believe that, but Jesus has forgiven me of my sins, because I don't want to do the things that the world is doing, and I know that I am saved because I live for Jesus, and Jesus, I'm saved by grace. Am I right?
Yes. Well, if you find in your life a real desire to do the will of God, so that you're greatly troubled if you do fall into a sin, that's in, and you delight in the Word of God, in the Bible, and everything that is there, and are ready to be obedient to what we find there, then that can be evidence in your life that indeed you can know you have become saved.
Yes, I be obedient, and I know nothing could change my lifestyle but the blood of Jesus. I came to Him. He saved me, and I have the assurance that I am saved, and I am waiting for His return, because He shall return for His people. Am I right?
Well, yes. That's the desire of every true believer, that mm-hmm. we are waiting for His return. Mm-hmm. But in the meanwhile, We know that we are ambassadors of Christ, and so we seek opportunities where we can witness to others and assist in getting the gospel out, the true gospel out into the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and I'll talk to you another time.
Thank you for calling, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes, hello, Mr. Camping. How are you tonight? Very good.
Very well, thank you.
Good. You sound very good. I just called last August.
Could you turn your radio off, please?
Okay. How is it now?
Let's try it.
Okay. I called you last month.
Yes.
I was at a Borders bookstore right before I spoke to you, and I just was in one tonight. I'm on Long Island, New York, and when your book first came out, you had to order it, and I seen that there were many orders, and they did stock them. Now I'm there tonight, and they say, oh, well, you can order it individually, but we're not going to stock them. So they said we could try Barnes & Noble, and they do the same thing. So I just want to let you know, it's a very good book, and it should be on the shelf. And, you know, I don't know if you can put pressure on anyone or not, but in New York, it's not very open.
All right. Well, we'll have to wait. The Lord is in charge of all this, and we are working on some things that will probably encourage this along, but try to be patient.
Yeah, okay. I have some copies. I lent them out after I've read it.
You can.
I ask you one question.
Yes.
Why do you think with the dinosaurs and man living together, they haven't found any fossils of man, only animals?
Well,
is it something God maybe didn't want us as far as to test us?
No. First of all, about 95% of the fossils that have been found are sea creatures of various kinds.
Uh-huh.
Once in a while, they find a land animal like that we call a dinosaur.
Right.
Basically, they were sea creatures, and that is, they were living in the sea. And as the waters came and the great mud flows developed, sea creatures were covered by the mud. And under the pressure and the intense heat that was developed, their bones fossilized, and so we have the record of them today. Now, mankind basically lived out in the open in cities, and they would have simply been all wiped away. But occasionally, they have found, maybe in a deep hole in the ground or in a cavern or in a cave or something, some evidence of human beings who would have lived before the flood. And such a find was recently reported in a cave about 1,600 feet above sea level in Indonesia. And so that seems to indicate that, and because these individuals were trapped in that cave, and their bones didn't even fossilize, they were simply covered in layers of mud.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Brother Campion?
Yes.
Oh, hello. I'm calling about Revelations 9, chapter 6.
Revelation 9, chapter 6. Let's look Let's look at that. Revelation 9, verse 6.
Mm-hmm.
We read there, and in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. Is that the verse? Yeah, that's, like I indicated the other week, that's a very, very difficult passage, but from the context of where it is from what it is saying, the death that mankind seeks and cannot find is the death associated with salvation. They are seeking to be identified with Christ in his death as he endured the wrath of God for our sins, And yet it's a time when there is no one becoming saved. The context, I believe, here is talking about what's happening in the local congregations in our day. Because while this is a very peculiar way to speak about salvation, it's the only solution that I can see as to how to understand this verse. And when we become saved, we are seeking to experience the second death through Christ, not for ourselves, not by ourselves going to hell, but by Christ doing it on our behalf. And if there's no salvation going on, that is, if the Holy Spirit is not applying the word to our life, then we can't have that identification.
I'll try to meditate on that and think about what you said. Also, I'd just like to ask about what you think of the Seventh-day Adventist Bible-based idea of the Seventh-day Sabbath as opposed to the first-day Sabbath. I've done a little bit of I'm not a Seventh-day Adventist, but I've done a little bit of reading about that, and I just wanted to see what you thought about that.
Well, the problem is that they have a lot of other problems ahead of that. First of all, they have a different kind of a gospel than a true gospel, because they believe that their divine authority is more than just the Bible. It is the Bible plus the writings of Ellen G. White, who had a series of visions and who wrote extensively, and they trust that as having been inspired by God. And so they're in violation of Revelation 22, verse 18, which says, if we add to the words of the prophecy of this book, we are still under the plagues thereof. And that is the reason they have an entirely wrong understanding of the seventh-day Sabbath, then have no understanding of how God has shifted or has ended, or actually, the seventh-day Sabbath observance, and has begun a new Sabbath, which is every Sunday. And the Bible is very clear. For example, if you read Colossians chapter 2, verse 16, it speaks there of the new moons and the laws concerning meat and drink, other ceremonial laws, in other words, and the Sabbaths, which would be the seventh-day Sabbaths, which were a shadow of things to come. Now, the shadow has no substance, and the seventh-day Sabbath was simply a sign pointing us to the fact that we are not to try to do any work ourselves to get ourselves saved. So anyway, it is something that is altogether alien to the Bible. It is not faithful in any way, either as a whole denomination or in connection with that, with the way they understand that particular law. However, the fact is, there's no denomination that God is utilizing any longer today. The church age has been finished, and so there's no one becoming saved in any denomination, whether it's Baptist or Methodist or Roman Catholic or Mormon or Presbyterian or Reformed or whatever. But thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Good evening, Harold. On the seventh-day Sabbath, since that's a shadow, and it was to be kept during the church age, now that the church age is no longer,
are we still to recognize the Sunday Sabbath?
Yes.
Excuse me. Let me interrupt a moment here. It was a shadow at the time that it was to be observed, and it was not to be observed during the church age. It was to be observed during the days when God was focusing on national Israel. It was on the same level with burnt offerings and blood sacrifices and the Passover day and so on. Now, during the church age, the churches were not to observe burnt offerings or blood sacrifices or the seventh-day Sabbath or the Passover. God gave other ceremonial laws that were shadows, namely the Lord's Supper and water baptism, and they were to be observed during the church age. But the seventh-day Sabbath was a shadow just like the other Old Testament ceremonial laws and was not to be observed at all during the church age.
Oh, when we meet, you know, outside of the church in our fellowship, the meeting having, to meet on a Sunday, we don't have to meet on a Sunday, we can meet on any day.
Well, there are people who argue, you know, that any day is a good day for the Sabbath, and that is just not true. That is not true. God indicated in Matthew 28, verse 1, that there was the end of an era of Sabbaths that had just finished. The statement is made early Sunday morning when Christ just arose from the grave. And now, as it says, as it began to dawn toward the first of the Sabbaths, there's a new era of Sabbaths. Sunday is the Sabbath. And there are people who say, well, we can make any day the Sabbath. Yeah, there's always people who know more than God, who really have their minds decided that they can figure out what is reasonable and what makes sense. But that is not the way we are to live. We are to live only in accordance with God's will. And God has established Sunday as the New Testament Sabbath, but it is a different Sabbath altogether from the seventh-day Sabbath. It is not a ceremonial law. It is simply a day which God has set aside so that we have time and an opportunity to spend in the Word of God and in sending the gospel out and so on. But thank you for calling and sharing.
Hey, Harold?
Yes?
So the verses that talk about, not esteeming one day above another, that application isn't for, like this latter rain time when the churches have ended, we still should worship on a Sunday?
Well, the fact is God has established Sunday as a Sabbath, as God has done that. It is not something that man has done. God has done that. But now we have to pause for this message. We're continuing with our open forum program, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to open forum.
Yes, Brother Kaplan, I have a question.
Yes.
Earlier on, when you first started teaching on the end of church age, you have made a reference in reference to tithing, referring that according to scripture as being a fellowship. I was wondering if you can give me a reference to where I can find the passage that you're talking about in the Bible.
You mean where you can find the verses that talk about the end of the church age?
Actually, it's not about the end. You were talking about the end of the church age, and somebody had asked you a question about tithing, and you said something
about tithing.
The end of church had ended, and you said something in reference to the tithing actually is referring to fellowship in the sense like bringing...
Well, now, tithing is simply a practice of providing funds. In the Old Testament, it was to provide funds to support the tribe of Levi, from whom the priesthood came and the temple worship and so on. In the New Testament, tithing was not commanded. God gave another command, namely that I beseech you, brethren, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, and God loveth a cheerful giver, and so on. But the point is that God had given a command to the churches, that command was to get the gospel out into the world. And as people became saved, they were the fruit of sending out the gospel, which were typified by the fruits that were brought in to the temple treasury in the Old Testament as tithes. And that is why tithing was not wrong at all. In the New Testament, it was a method of providing funds so that the gospel could go out into the world, so that people might become saved and brought into the kingdom of God. And also they were cautioned and taught to, if possible, become a part of a local congregation. So now the church age is over, and God has still a great program to save people. We still have the command. Every true believer still has the command to go out into all the world. So again, our tithing money, or all that we want to make available in obedience to God's command to lay down our lives as an offering, as a on the altar of sacrifice, should be used to get the true gospel out into the world. It can be done through a ministry like Family Radio. It can be done personally by buying Bibles and sharing them. There's a lot of different ways that this can be done. But the idea of making our funds available to get the gospel into the world, that has not changed for a bit, just because we're at the end of the church age.
Mr. President, where can I find the Bible where it makes reference of tithing as to sending out of the gospel?
The Bible does not speak about New Testament tithing. You read Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice. And in Luke chapter 6, we read, let me read a verse there. And God says in Luke chapter 6, if I remember correctly, Luke 6 in verse 38, give, and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. Now, give what? You see, God, if we become a child of God, we have to get the larger picture here. When we are a child of God, we are owned by Christ. And everything, our strength, our wisdom, our job, our health, our inheritance that we might receive or whatever, is put into our care, not so that we can have as rich a life in this world as possible. That's what the world seeks. It's all for me. I want a bigger house. I want more money in the bank for security. I want more toys. I want this. I want that. I want the other thing. It's all for me. That's the world. But when we become saved, we are owned by Christ, and He gives us money that we can earn or we possess, not for our just to enjoy this world, but that we can get on with the task that God has assigned us. And what is that task? To send the gospel out into the world. And in our day, it's a very, very serious gospel, because we also have to send out the warning that judgment day is almost here. And that's the task of every true believer. So, okay, I have this money that's under my care that God has assigned to me. I have this income from my job. And now, I have to live, but I want to make as much as possible available that the gospel can go out. And some people may decide 10% of all that they own would be a good amount to make to give. Others are able to give 20% or 30%. I know of one individual who became quite wealthy who started giving 90% of his income to the Lord's work, because he recognized that he had been, God had put this wealth under his care to use to God's glory. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hi. Now, I know that you have come to the conclusion that the second half hour of the tribulation will be 17 years in length. This, however, will not harmonize with the Bible, because according to Daniel 8:14, the first half hour of the tribulation lasted for a little over 6 years. Therefore, only if we add an 11-year second half hour to this will we find harmony with Jacob's 17 years in Egypt.
Therefore, you believe that Christ is going to return when?
October 2005.
In October of October. I believe you told, said another time, October 3rd, October of year 2005. So we'll just wait about 2 more weeks.
Okay.
And find out whether you're right or not, okay?
All righty. Have a nice night.
Yeah. Thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hello?
Yes, good evening.
Hello?
Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hi, Brother Kenton.
Turn your radio off, please.
Hello?
Please turn your radio off. I guess we lost that caller. Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
How you doing, Brother Kenton?
Yes.
I have a question for you, because I cannot decide what, you know, the when the day is start and when the day is finished, because sometimes I have to find a job that they told me to work in nighttime, but I cannot, you know.
But what is your question?
I want to know what time you can start work is, can start working, like after the you know, Sundays, what time is...
Okay. What your
from 6 to
question,
6 or...
Yeah. Your question is a... when the Bible says that the Sabbath, the New Testament Sabbath day, is Sunday, when does it begin and when does it end? From the evidence of the Bible, I would have to say that it begins at midnight at the beginning of Sunday and goes till midnight at the beginning of Monday. In other words, that 24-hour period. Now, the reason I say that is, number one, it was early in the morning on Sunday that God indicated that it was dawning toward the first of the Sabbath, a new era of Sabbath, and that was when the women came to anoint the body of Jesus, so that would imply that it began before dark, which would be, or before the sun came up. That is, it would be long before 6 o'clock in the morning. Then in the book of Acts, it speaks there of Paul preaching, I think it was in the city of Troas, until midnight. And God calls attention to that. So combining those two citations, I believe God is teaching us we have to understand that it is the 24 hours from midnight to midnight. And thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good
yes,
evening.
Harold.
Welcome to Open Forum.
How you doing, Harold?
Very well, thank you.
I was just wondering, the prophet Jonah saved?
If what?
If Jonah the prophet was saved.
The apostles?
Yeah, the apostles.
Well, from what we can know, we know Nathanael was saved for certain. We know the Apostle John was saved for certain. We know that Peter was saved for certain. There's no evidence of any kind. In fact, in the high priestly prayer of Christ in the upper room on that we read about in John 17, I think we can understand from some of the language there that except for Judas, who betrayed Jesus, all of the apostles were saved.
And how did Judas betray?
I'm sorry?
He betrayed Jesus?
Yeah, Judas. Well, now Christ, you see, he chose Judas, knowing full well that Judas was not a saved man, because Jesus knew the heart of man. And yet God, Christ was setting the apostolic band up so that the proper actions would take place that would lead to the crucifixion of Christ. And part of that program was that he was to be betrayed by someone who was a very dear friend. And this led him to also choose Judas. Now, Judas, in the eyes of the other apostles, were just like the rest of them. They couldn't tell that he was not saved at all. But Christ knew. Christ, in fact, in John 6, he underscores this also as he speaks of Judas as the son of perdition.
Okay, is this supposed to happen like that at the end of this world, that he's going to be, Jesus is going to be betrayed?
I'm sorry, could you speak up a little more?
Is Jesus supposed to be betrayed at the end of this world too, as he was on the cross?
Yes.
Is it going to happen like that at the end of the world?
Well, at the end of the world, I don't know how it's all going to end up, except that the moment that we see Christ on the clouds of glory, then all kinds of dramatic things will be happening, but I have no way of knowing specifically just what it is. All I know, I know in the broad brush, the broad sweep, the true believers are going to be raptured to be with Christ. Those who are living at that time will instantly receive their glorified spiritual bodies. And I know that all the unsaved, both those who have lived and died in the past, as well as those presently living, will be standing very much alive to take their turn answering to God at the judgment throne. They will be put on trial and be found guilty and cast into hell. Now, those facts we know. We also know that the whole universe is going to be destroyed by fire, and God will create a new universe, new heavens and new earth, where the true believers will dwell with Christ forevermore. Now, we know those statements, that really encompasses the big look at it, but insofar as the detail of moment by moment, once Christ appears, I don't know. I don't think we have enough information in the Bible to know, except that it's going to be very, very traumatic for the unsaved. They'll be weeping and gnashing their teeth and trying to hide from the presence of God. And for the true believers, we will simply go to be with him. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes, hi. There were multiple prophets that came on this earth with God's teaching. Is that correct?
Were there more than one prophets?
Yeah, multiple prophets.
Well, the fact is, beginning with Christ returning to heaven a couple of thousand years ago, every true believer is a prophet. A man, a woman, a child, anyone who becomes a true believer is a legitimate prophet.
Okay, I guess maybe I should say this. There was four holy books, right? The Bible, if from what I'm studying, it is four books comprised into one. There's the the Torah, the Injil, I believe it is, like the first five chapters, and then the Revelations is the last book, and like the scrolls of Abraham. But there was prophets who all had a book.
Well, now let me tell you something. You know, there are lots of books that have been written critiquing the Bible, and they're not listening to the Bible. They are seeking information here and there, and wherever they can find it, and none of that information is accurate or trustworthy. And based on that kind of information, they write a very interesting book about how the Bible came into being or whatever. They don't read the Bible. The Bible is the Word of God, all the way from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, to Revelation chapter 22, the last verse, is from the mouth of God. Holy men of old, holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is eternal God.
So who wrote the book in Genesis before Jesus came? There was no, who was that prophet who wrote that? How did we get that information if it's all in one Bible?
Well, you know, it's God who wrote it, and the scribe that wrote it down was Moses, who lived about 9,500 years after what happened in the book of Genesis, that is at the very beginning. And he wrote about extensively about conversations and so on. Now, it wasn't because he was present. It is because God put the words into Moses' mouth. It is God's word that wrote it. And let me give you an illustration of how the Bible came into being. If we go to Jeremiah. Now, you don't find this in any of the books that you're reading. And yet, the Bible is true and trustworthy. It is absolutely dependable. Now, here in Jeremiah chapter 35, we read there, I think it's chapter 36. Now, this is here, God is giving us an illustration of how the Bible came into existence. And it came to pass, I'm reading from Jeremiah chapter 36, and remember this is, well, let's see what happens. It came to pass in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, that this word came unto Jeremiah from the Lord, that is from Jehovah, saying, now here's God speaking, take thee a roll of a book, and write therein all the words that I have spoken unto thee against Israel, against Judah, and against all the nations from the day I spake unto thee, even in the days of Josiah, even unto this day. In other words, everything we find in the book of Jeremiah, which is quite a large book in the Old Testament, God is saying, I gave those words to you, you write them down. And then then we read in verse 4, then Jeremiah called Baruch, the son of Neriah. He apparently was the secretary of Jeremiah. And Baruch wrote from the mouth of Jeremiah all the words of the Lord, which he had spoken unto him upon a roll of a book. Now that is describing to us how God has given us the Bible. And none of those books that you're reading will make any reference to this, I'm quite certain.
No, they do, but the only thing is, I just didn't see how, why, I don't, you know, I'm just kind of scared to put Jesus before God, you know. Yeah, and if Jesus is the Son of God, how come we don't call him Jesus Jr.?
Yeah,
you know, that's just not right. I mean, it's really, I'm just scared. You know, eternity is forever. And there's too many things, you know, too many prophets came on this earth and they all had books. And why are we just worshiping one and we're not worshiping God? Wow. God made us. He made everything. And I'm a Christian, but that's the only part that I don't do is, I don't say anything, you know, I don't use Jesus' name. I only use God's name in the place that I believe that God is the one that's going to judge me. I don't believe that if I accept Jesus Christ in my heart, I'm not going to be judged after I'm dead on the day of judgment.
Well, I mean, the fact is that if you want to know truth, you have to find it only from the Bible and not from the books that you are reading and where they're talking about how the Bible came into existence. Those books do not understand the writers. I've never read any of those books, and I've read some of them, where they had the slightest notion of really what the Bible really is. For example, we read in the book of Jude in the New Testament where Jude excuse me, where Jude is speaking about words that Enoch, who lived 7,000 years earlier, approximately, uttered. How did Jude know what Enoch said? Was he back there? Was there any record that he found someplace? Of course not. It is because God was giving him the words to write. And so the whole, the bottom line of it all is read the Bible. Read the Bible. And don't read these books that try to tell you how the Bible came into existence or what this prophet said or that prophet said. As a matter of fact, when Jeremiah is speaking, it is God speaking. When Moses spoke, it was God speaking. When Elijah spoke, it was God speaking. When James or John or Matthew spoke, it was God speaking. And this is not well understood at all, but that is what the Bible teaches us. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum. Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum. The number to call, incidentally, is 1-800.
Hi.
Yes, go ahead. Good evening.
Hi. My sister called a little over 2 weeks ago, and now I'm calling because I have one comment, please. Because we know from Jeremiah 29, verses 4 through 7, that Judah's captivity in Babylon during the second part of the 70-year tribulation is a picture of the latter rain, we therefore can be absolutely sure that the 11th year of Zedekiah's reign in Jeremiah 1:3, which would have been the year 587 B.C. when Judah was carried away captive into Babylon, is pointing us to an 11-year latter reign. And an 11-year latter rain brings us to 12 o'clock noon Jerusalem time on October 4th, 2005, for Christ's announcement. Thank you.
All right. Now that you have given us that information, we'll patiently wait for October 4th and see once what happens. I'll make a prediction that we're all going to be here October 5th and 6th and 7th, and there's because I find not the slightest evidence in the Bible that the end of the world is going to happen in the year 2005. But you've made your declaration, and now we'll see what happens. Shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hey, Brother Captain?
Yes. Go ahead.
Brother Campbell?
Yes.
Yes. I have a question concerning sin. Is it a sin to sell, like, illegal drugs?
Is it a sin to do which?
Like, to sell illegal drugs.
To sell illegal drugs?
You got it, yes.
Well, of course it's a sin because it's a crime. Any crime against the law of the land is a sin. We are to be obedient to those who rule over us, and if they make a law that you are to not to sell illegal drugs, well then you know that is sin.
And it's also a crime to do them, right?
Pardon?
And it's also a sin to do illegal drugs too,
well,
right?
Well, of course it is. That's anything that is illegal is sin, unless God, unless there was a law. If the law said that you had to tell lies, well, then you have to disobey the law. Then you, because God's law overrules that. But if the law says that there are certain drugs that are bad for you and you should not take them, well, okay, then obey those laws. Otherwise, you are in rebellion. First of all, against your country, but you're also in rebellion against God. But thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Good evening, Mr. Camping.
Yes.
I'd like to ask you two basic questions or information. First of all, I had mentioned that to you some time ago, but I had not gotten a direct answer from you, as you seem to be someone who likes to give very explicit answers. Now you have been saying that after the fall of man, that man had lost his free will. Now, I have looked into the Bible, and I have
Now, wait, excuse me. You said that I said what? That when we have a brand new soul, we've lost our free will?
Man, Adam and Eve.
Oh, okay, all right.
I'm
Go ahead.
Sorry. Okay. After man had disobeyed God, he had sinned, you said that man had lost his free will.
That is correct.
Now, I see very explicitly in the Bible that after man had sinned, God did not remove from man any of the specific things that he had built man with. He had simply punished man by removing him from the garden.
Excuse me, we're going to have to pause for this message. We just had a caller on the line who was indicating that he questioned whether it's correct that we can say that after Adam and Eve sinned, they lost their free will. And I want to define what that means. It did not mean they no longer had a free will to make choices throughout the daytime or nighttime. They could choose the wife they were going to marry, or they could choose what part of the country they wanted to live in, or they could choose all kinds of things. They had that kind of free will. Of course, man has not lost that. But when we normally talk about free will in theological circles or in church circles, we're talking about free to choose Christ if I so want to do so. I am an unsaved man, yet I have a free will, and in any time that I desire, I can choose for Christ. And the answer is, no, you can't. You have lost that area of free will because the Bible teaches you have become a slave of Satan. You have become a slave of sin. In your ego, think you still have a free will. Oh, I can choose Christ anytime I want. Sure, you can choose what kind of a religion you want to follow, and there are a great many possibilities. You can make that choice, but insofar as choosing to become a true believer, you can choose to become a Christian. Of course you can. You can choose. You can choose to. You can try to find the body of believers that seem to be as faithful as possible, and you can choose to become a part of them. But insofar as choosing to come under God's salvation plan exactly the way God sets it forth, no, you'll never choose for that because you are dead in your sins. You can choose to be a very religious person, a very good person, to follow the Bible. You can choose all those things. Of course you can. But you can't choose to get saved. You can't choose the true gospel. In other words, with the idea that because I chose the true gospel, now I am a child of God. God has to choose us. We are corpses. We are dry bones. There's no way that we will ever seek him and or choose him. That is not possible. And that's why Joshua, you know, when you read around Joshua 3 or 24, as Joshua is giving his farewell speech, he's saying, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether it's the gods across the river or the gods of your fathers or words to that effect or some other god of the nation. You can choose amongst all the heathen possibilities, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. They were not asked to choose between those other gods and the God of the Bible, because they follow the rules of the Bible. A lot of people choose the God of the Bible, but then they believe that they can get right with them, with God, on their own plan, not on God's plan. But shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Oh, hi, Mr. Camping. If you could answer, did Jesus actually physically drink wine as an alcoholic drink?
Absolutely not. We know that absolutely. Because the Bible teaches that when a priest went about his priestly duties, he was not to eat, drink wine or strong drink, and Christ was a high priest. And secondly, the Bible says it is not for kings to drink wine or desire strong drink, and Christ never ceased to be a king. And so there's no possibility that he drank any wine or alcoholic beverage.
The Passion of the Christ, the movie that came out last year, I remember when it came out, you answered several questions, and you came out against it, as well I. And as it stands today, the truth does come out that $500 million was made off that movie. And that leads me to another question. Where does it say in Scripture that you are not to fill your bellies with the selling of the gospel?
Bellies with the what?
Selling.
Or the selling of
the gospel. The
gospel,
filling your bellies by selling the gospel.
Well, the Bible doesn't use that kind of language. At least I'm not aware of that language. But the Bible warns against merchandising the gospel, or that's found in a number of places. I can't right offhand put my finger on it. But that is a theme that is found in the Bible, where people are using the money. For example, if you read Jeremiah, God is really faulting speaking against the, first of all, as an example against Judah of his day, but that was an example of God speaking against the local congregations of our day, and it speaks about the pastors who were in the business for their own wealth and not for the good of the sheep at all, and words of that to that effect. But under no circumstance. Oh, for example, and I'm thinking, in First Peter, here, let me turn to that a moment. I think there we might find a verse in First Peter. If I remember, let me see, where it says, as it talks about pastors, that they are to be faithful, or here in chapter 5, here God is in, here's an admonition to the local pastors and elders, verse 2, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre. Now, filthy lucre has to do with the money, the things that the world is interested in, but of a ready mind, neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being examples to the flock. That's just one little passage that identifies with that kind of an idea.
One more, if I may. Just to vindicate you, because I was quite cynical about the end of the church age, and I still don't think it's all the way there yet. I think there's still a small remnant of good churches left, but I've discovered through cultural issues and trying to do outreach in churches and being inside churches and not being invited in because they're quote-unquote too liberal, and I think you should be very well vindicated in the Scripture about the church. A lot of the churches are dead.
Well, the fact is, if anybody is honest and looks around and has had any experience with local congregations, and compares with what they see today, say over against what they saw 30 years ago, they'd have to say something has happened. Because while here and there, there might be a little church still trying to hang on, basically there's vast differences. And even that little church that's trying to hang on has modified their doctrines also. They're talking way more, they're allowing divorce for fornication, and so that the marriage institution has been destroyed, and they're part of it, and as well as some other doctrines. And they're not talking about hell and damnation nearly like they used to. There is just an enormous difference of what is happening. Now, most people in the churches are in denial. They don't want to admit that. They don't want to recognize that, but they're in pure denial. It is a fact. And but even with that, that is not the test. That's not the vindication. That's not the vindication. The vindication is, what does the Bible say? This is the only thing that can vindicate a position. We have to learn from the Bible. We never can develop doctrine based on what we see out there. It just happens to be that we first developed from the Bible the fact that this, we would come to this time and have come to this time of the end of the church age. And now from the Bible, we began to learn about how bad the churches would be. And now as we look at the local congregations, we are seeing this right before our eyes, that it is just like the Bible said it would be. And I can go one step further. What we're seeing today is not as bad as what we're going to see tomorrow. In other words, if for example, we were getting information here and there and yonder and hither and so on, that here's a denomination, here's a congregation that are really troubled by what is going on, and they're spending days and weeks in soul searching and researching the Bible, where did we go wrong and what, and so on, and there was a real sitting in sackcloth and ashes, so to speak, because of what's happening. We'd have to say, well, somehow what we're seeing doesn't measure up to what the Bible predicted. But isn't it significant? We don't see any of that. I haven't heard of any denominations that are really seriously troubled by what they have done to the marriage institution, or what is happening in the other congregations. Every congregation, of course, thinks, oh, we're okay, we're okay. It's the other ones out there. But the fact is that they better look at the whole mix, and they'll find that it all fits the biblical prophecy precisely. But thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yeah, hi. My question is, I have a friend, and she asked me that if God knew who he was going to save, and he knew most people in the world throughout history will be going to hell, she says she feels that that's cruel, that since he knew this was going to happen beforehand, and I want to know what kind of scripture I could give her.
Well, the fact is, we are all by nature in rebellion against God. We're all the criminals in the dungeon. And of course we're going to argue about what the king has done in putting us in the dungeon. Take any criminal that stands before the judge. Is he going to be just delighted with the ruling of the judge? No, he's going to criticize the judge. He didn't understand, and so on and so on. And that's exactly what we try to do. We try to put God in trouble. We try to say, how could a good God do these things? Now, what we don't understand is that God, you have to start right out with Genesis chapter 1, where God says he created mankind in his image, and everything was perfect. In his likeness, we were perfect. But God gave a command that if you disobey me, and he used the illustration of a tree that he called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat of the fruit of that tree, which I am telling you not to eat of, then you will come under my wrath. You will be subject to death. And God did not make man eat of that tree. Mankind, of his own volition, of his own will, ate of that tree. And now God has no pleasure and no happiness. I can point to verses where God weeps over what he must do to the unsaved. We read about the Lord Jesus as he is looking at Jerusalem that is under the wrath of God, and Jesus wept. He is weeping. And God says it simply, he has no pleasure in the death of the wicked, none whatsoever. But the law of God has to be followed. God is under the law of God, and the law is the whole Bible. God is under that law. And the law of God declares there must be punishment. It's just like, to use a human illustration, here is a judge. And the law says that if a certain crime has been performed or has been done, then if a person is found guilty, it means this person has to be put away for the rest of his life, or he has to be executed, or whatever the law demands. And now comes this individual before the judge, and he is found guilty. He is guilty. And this judge says, oh, I just don't have the heart. I know the law says that this person has to be executed, but I don't have the heart to make that pronouncement, so I'm just going to give him 10 years in jail. Now, that judge has violated the law. He is guilty of breaking the law himself. If the law stipulates that for that kind of a crime, there is to be execution. And God, of course, is perfect. He has to keep the law. Christ can weep over Jerusalem. God can weep and be greatly troubled that he has no pleasure in the death or the damnation of the wicked. But God has got to keep the law perfectly. And it's not because God is sinning. It's because God doesn't want to sin. He has to keep his perfection. And it is man who has brought this upon himself. And that's just the way the situation is. And there's no remedy except God has provided a way for a great many to escape all of this. And it took an enormous cost on God's part, in that Christ had to, the individuals that do become saved, it means that Christ had to take their sins and bear the wrath of God in their place. And what an enormous cost to the Lord Jesus. Talk about a cruel God, forget it. Talk about a loving God that we don't understand. I ask that question 1,000 times. Why did God save me? I certainly am not worthy in any way. And I know what an enormous cost it was to God to save me, because it meant that every dirty, rotten sin I'd ever committed or had committed in my whole lifetime had to be laid on the Lord Jesus. And he had to be found guilty for my sins, my dirty, rotten sins. And he had to bear the wrath of God in my place. Wow, what a love God has. Why would he do that? And why me and not somebody else? And that's true of every true believer. That's the way we feel.
Okay, but thank you.
Thank you for calling and sharing. And shall we take our next call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum. Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Yes, sir. Mr. Campy.
Yes.
What is the criteria for the end of the church age?
What is the criteria? The criteria is the Bible. The Bible has an enormous amount of information that lays out the timeline of God's the unveiling of God's salvation plan, and it focuses on the year, from everything I can read, it appears to focus on the year 2011. Could you turn your radio off, please? Please. Yeah. And you see, God has given us an enormous amount of information concerning the time that is past. And as we examine in very great detail when this happened and that happened, the important milestones, the important points in time when there were important things happened, we find that it was not an irrational, haphazard pattern at all. It followed a very precise pattern, and events were related to each other in very significant time paths. And as we extend them to the end, what looks like the end of the world, following the same methodology as he has done it in the past, and picking up the patterns that God has laid down so that we can see from those what the pattern will be right near the end, the evidence focuses on the year 2011 to a very high degree.
Yes, the reason I'm calling is you often say, well, we know it's the end of the church age because we see churches failing in this doctrine or that doctrine. And I just want to know that if I find a church that is totally faithful to the Bible, faithful to all the truthful doctrines, would that mean that you're wrong?
Well, it's impossible, because if they were faithful to all the truths of the Bible, they wouldn't be a church any longer. They would recognize that God is not using a church anymore to evangelize. So they would disband and not be a church any longer if they were altogether faithful to the Word of God. It's impossible. And secondly, we have to remember, as I indicated a few minutes ago, doctrine is not established by looking out there at what's happening in the churches or in the world. Doctrine is established, true doctrine is established, by finding it in the Bible. That is what sets the stage. And then, if we have come to truth, or think we have come to truth from what the Bible teaches, then it's possible that as we look out at the world and look at people and ourselves and so on, we will see that it fits, that everything fits together. And that's exactly what we're seeing. But the doctrines, the teachings, were not developed by what we see out there, but what we read in the Bible. Just the fact of the existence of family radio, which is a total anomaly, that we are more and more concerned about the Bible alone and being absolutely true to the Bible in every evidence, every way. How can that be? And yet when we study the Bible, we find, yes, there will be those that are, in spite of the fact that the church age is finished, there will be those who will continue to faithfully declare the Word of God. The truth is first established from the Bible, not from what we see out here. But thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our next call, please?
Yeah, how you doing, Brother Campbell? Nice to talk to you.
Yes.
In Mark chapter 14, verse 23, could you read that for me, please?
Let's look at that. Mark
chapter 14, verse 23 to 25.
Let's look at that. Mark chapter 14, verse 23 to 25. There we read, and Jesus is instituting the ceremonial law of the Lord's Supper.
Mm-hmm.
And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
Yes, brother. I believe a question came up to you before if he had ever drank wine, and he's saying he won't drink of it again, so I guess he did drink it at some time in his life.
Well, now, this is the fruit of the vine, and is not talking about wine here. Now, what is the fruit of the vine? First of all, it is grape juice.
Okay.
And that certainly is not alcoholic.
True. What I was thinking is did he also mean that during ceremonial rites we only drink grapefruit juice, or are we going to drink wine?
The Bible doesn't tell us. We can speculate, but the Bible doesn't tell us. It just is saying, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine. And we can read anything we want into that, but it's going to be pure speculation. And we remember the biblical rule that we compare Scripture with Scripture. And when we read that a high priest was never, in his going about his priestly duties, was never to drink wine, and a king was not to drink wine, then we know that we're incorrect in suggesting that this would have been wine that he had been drinking. But thank you for calling and sharing, and shall we take our last call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Brother Cappy?
Yes.
Let me cut down my radio.
Yeah, turn your radio off, please.
Don, give you a confirmation on that end of the church aid, and the Lord had revealed to me. I guess what a lot of people get confused is that they got to understand who's the prince of this world, which is Satan. And Satan's going to always set up his kingdom just to deceive those who are the true believers, because God is calling his believers out of the church, and I just want to make sure everybody got understanding on that.
All right, thank you for sharing that. And shall we take our last call, please? Good evening. Welcome to Open Forum.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes. I was wondering if the early church wrote the New Testament and then put the whole Bible together, that would mean that the early church came before the Bible did, right?
No, the early church did not write the Bible. God wrote the Bible. And he used the Apostle Paul, he used the Apostle John, he used Peter, Matthew, Mark, Luke, maybe Jude. Basically, they are the men, and all of them, incidentally, were living, except the Apostle John. The Apostle John was living after the church age had really taken off, after the first missionaries had been sent out. But it's not the early church that wrote the Bible. God wrote the Bible. But now we've come to the end of our time. Until our next open forum, may the Lord richly bless you. Good night.